Welcome to the Game Think Talk Show. I'm Matt. That's Matt. Over there. We're talking about video game stuff. Biggest thing today, Matt, other than how are you doing?
I'm doing well. Thanks for sneaking that in.
This must...
And biggest... What's up?
Keep going.
Biggest thing is going to be different depending on who you ask. The biggest thing for me that I got the biggest kick out of was some random dude.
Yeah, that's right.
And it doesn't work in the industry. He's not a celebrity. He's not a games journalist. Just a random Joe Average.
Gaffer.
Got his Nintendo Switch delivered to the door 2 weeks early before launch. It was brought up matter-of-factly in a NeoGAF thread where somebody posted a picture of a Switch like in its box. And they're like, did anybody see this? I think people are getting Switches early. And it turned out that picture was just like a promo somewhere. But the guy saw the picture and he was like, oh, here's mine. And he posted it on a picture of a Switch on his bed. And everybody flipped out. Nobody could believe it. And he was so nonchalant. Like, it was just... He figured everybody was getting Nintendo Switches early. So, of course, everybody thought it was fake. And they were like, dude, you have to upload a video right now. If this is real. Like, if... Because he was like, I don't have any games. Like, all I can do is just flip through the menu. We were like, we want to see that.
That's
huge.
That's enough. That's...
You're the first person in the world to be able to access this operating system and go into the options and fiddle around.
And it's still probably the second best launch game, just the menu at this point.
Yeah, right. Well, better than 1-2 Switch. So he did it. He finally came through. He uploaded a video and the thread was going nuts as he was uploading it. And we finally got a good look. And, you know, it's exactly, you know, what he said. It's just the bare bones, like nothing's connected to the internet. The news section is just like really basic how to do this and how to play it on the TV stuff. So there's nothing super exciting there, but you saw it. I mean, it's very sleek and responsive, and the operating system is very minimal. It's just snappy and simple, which in my opinion, that was kind of my best case scenario. I wanted something similar to, you know, the 3DS, where it was just only what you needed right there.
Yeah.
Everything's a tap away. And yeah, it looked really, really sleek.
I mean, some people are saying like, could this be fake? Looks pretty damn real. He would have to, like the way he's syncing up these Nintendo sounding sound effects. This isn't just like, remember that NX controller?
Oh yeah.
Forgery, you know, and that was a still image and that took some work too.
Yeah.
So this is, that's a Switch.
Yeah.
We know what they look like now. We've seen them. You've held them in your hand.
Yeah.
And, so that's real. But the strange thing is like, obviously this person's trying to stay anonymous. I think it comes off as very casual because they're trying to probably not get in trouble, whoever is putting this stuff up there.
Yep.
I mean, Nintendo's got to have a handle on who has these out in the wild.
Oh, yeah.
Whether, I don't know. I mean, all we can do is speculate whether it has anything to do with people they might have shipped them out to already, like manager of a retail store that might already have them, or it's somebody at Nintendo. It could be someone's uncle that works at Nintendo.
Likely.
Yeah. But it looks... I'd bet $100. I'd bet a Switch that it is true, but it looks great. I mean, the first thing you notice is, you know, for someone who hasn't been right up front with it, it's just, man, does it look better than the Wii U? The Wii U is a really good start, and that's where I am most excited about the Switch, is that it took everything I loved about the Wii U, and it just made that so much better. Whereas the other day I was trying to play in the toilet, and I was losing the connection to the screen.
Yeah.
You know, I could sneak in a Mario Kart race when I'm on the toilet. Several. And, but this, I mean, yeah, even if you're not going to be on, like, Japanese public transport, just the ability to have this thing out for a couple hours or just anywhere in your house, you know, lounging on a couch, I think is going to be great. And I know people are whining about the battery power, but you can get a USB charging stick. Those are very cheap. You know, like one of those little battery banks.
Yeah.
That'd be cool if Nintendo had like a case that held one of those things for you. I mean, you could just have a couple of those things. You can get other batteries for it.
I mean, what the heck, man? I mean, who plays for 5.5 hours straight on their handheld? And like, I consider myself a big handheld gamer. You know how much I love my 3DS. I talk about it all the time. I've had every single major handheld, and I mean that, since the very first Game Boy, from Sony and from Nintendo. I've had every handheld there's ever been, including like the shitty ones you bought in the store, like the Game & Watch that had like
the Tiger games?
Pictures. Like, yeah, those, exactly.
Those, it's better to play, it's better to imagine what a game is than play those.
For sure. And I remember getting Virtua Fighter, oh my one of those, God. And I was so disappointed.
Yeah, because they also set their standards so high. It's like, yeah. It's like the first time I tried to be a vegetarian just for fun. I bought all these things like, you know, fake hot dogs and stuff. But when you think it's a hot dog and you eat it, it's disgusting.
Why would you even call it a hot? That's my wife gets a lot of, she's not totally vegan, but she gets a lot of that stuff. And I hate it when they call them vegan hamburgers and vegan cheese. It's like, it's not cheese. Yeah. It's not a hamburger. Just call it something different.
Just call it fried. Anyway, sir. Yeah.
My point being is I've had every handheld and what was my point?
You've had every handheld. What was handheld. I talking about? Every Nintendo. How long people are going to play?
And battery life. Like, yeah. I never in my life have I spent over 5.5 hours just gaming on my hand. Like, even when I do it at separate points during the day,
yeah.
I think cumulatively, I've never spent, you know, 6 hours plus playing on this thing. I mean, flights and long drives, like, still, I take breaks. So, if you have a charging brick with you, you're never... I never say never. There are people out there who just go way too far, but the average gamer and even the hardcore gamer is not going to run out of battery life.
Yeah. I mean, and even if you're in your car, you could plug it in, or if you're in a train, you can plug it in, or a bus. I don't know if you said any of that when you just told me, but, I think that, come on, like, you're going to be running some pretty powerful games on this. Mm-hmm. I think anything less than 3 hours is getting to the point of why bother? And maybe a year into its life, if the battery dips down to about an hour at a time, that's a bit lame. But just the ability to have it moving around to another house, and even if you had to plug it in still, you know, even if you were as close to like a power supply, I like that idea, being able to lounge anywhere with it. So pretty excited for the Switch. Hopefully we get some more games for it. You know, real quick, this is something I mentioned here before about how excited I was that Steep was coming to the Switch.
Mm-hmm.
I put that on N4G and people were so like, they're like, no one cares about Steep, you idiot. No one likes it. And just, and I was like, you guys missed the point. Fucking Steep's on here. That's a big ass, beautiful looking game. I've mentioned this many times, but that's the most, it's so important. We're going to see games that big once the publishers see the millions of people that buy into the Switch. I think it's going to be big. That's the Super Bowl. People get it. People know what it is. And they stopped. Actually, this is a story we haven't talked about so far. Nintendo, did you hear any more about that story about them not continuing to manufacture the Mini NES?
Oh, you know what? I think they, I think that was an isolated thing. The Norwegian countries where that was going on, that was, I think that was isolated because Nintendo of Europe basically came out and said, nah, we're still making this thing. So, I think that was an isolated issue. I think in North America and Europe, we're still going to be seeing these.
All right. Because I was thinking that would make sense. And then they want to shuffle everybody over like, hey, you want to play those old games you liked and everything you grew up on? Here's a sweet little portable system.
Although something else we didn't, and this is just really quick, something else Switch related that we didn't mention, also Wii U related, is that the Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild is getting 2 DLC packs and an expansion pass for $20.
$20 for both?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for the whole lot.
Okay. Pretty neat.
Which I think sounds very fair.
Yeah, I think the biggest part of the story was that people were... I don't know if you'd ever heard the term Season Pass and Nintendo together. They seem to be buying into that. So,
and you know what? They should. They totally should.
Yeah. They should. It's, you know, I just finished Mankind Divided last night.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll get to it after we talk about For Honor. But
oh, okay.
I looked at the DLC for that, and the way they do the storytelling and the characterization is a million times better in this one cutscene than anywhere else in the game. But was there anything else you want to talk about Nintendo, or can we move on to More Honor?
I think that was all the Nintendo stuff today. I think that's it.
There it is. Some mystery. Maybe we'll find out a little later whose that was. Probably never. And until
we need a Nintendo Direct soon.
Yeah.
It's embarrassing that we saw all this from a random person before Nintendo actually showed it off 2 weeks before it launches. Are you kidding me? We don't. We need a Nintendo Direct for the internet service, for the OS, for a lot of that stuff. Like actually to get us excited about actually using it. We've seen games, but the Switch itself, we still have some questions that Nintendo has not answered. We need a Direct like yesterday. So hopefully,
is there anything scheduled?
No. It's utterly bizarre, but whatever.
Okay. I always get my Nintendo Directs indirectly from you. I don't know if they had I figured they had like a once a month drop going for that.
They do it whenever the hell they want.
That sounds more like Nintendo than what I had said. All right, man. You've been playing For Honor. You've been a huge proponent of this game all throughout the closed beta, all throughout the open beta. You went to the event at Ubisoft, and you've been in on the ground floor. And the game's out. You've played. What are your thoughts on the final product?
Man, well, I mean, my opinion hasn't really changed. The only reservation I had going into the full version of the game, there were two things. The main one was the story campaign, the single player campaign, because at the preview event in San Francisco, they let us try two separate missions from the single player campaign, neither of which impressed me. They were both fine. There was nothing wrong with them, but they weren't awesome. And so I thought, okay, maybe they knew people wanted a single player campaign. They know this is important to people. Maybe it's kind of shoehorned in, and you know, the game controls fantastic, so it's still going to be fun, but not as great as maybe it could have been or should have been. That's kind of how I was thinking going into it. Pleased to say that the single player campaign is like totally heavy metal. It's a lot of fun. There are in pretty much every single mission. The campaign's divided up into three parts. There is a knight campaign that you play through using multiple characters and classes, then a Viking campaign, and then a samurai campaign. And each of those little campaigns takes place over the course of about 12 years, leading up to the timeline, the multiplayer timeline. When you're in the multiplayer modes, the single player story campaign takes place about 12 years before any of that. So it really it provides like a really rich context and a lot of lore and a lot of urgency for players who are in this world playing these multiplayer modes. But in pretty much every single mission across all three of those mini campaigns for the Knights, Vikings, and Samurai, there are a lot of really epic moments. It almost felt like, you know, I haven't played any of the Uncharted games, but the way I hear about them, how they basically usher you from one amazing set piece to the next. For Honor feels like that. They kind of usher you from one awesome duel and battle to the next awesome large scale war going on, to the next little thing where you get to control a ballista and shoot through a bunch of dudes. And it's very well paced. The voice acting is actually, I was totally taken off guard and pleasantly surprised by the caliber and the quality of the voice acting. I was really pleased. It's nothing that the snobby cinema person who, you know, turns their nose up at video games is going to be impressed by, but you know, compared to the average video game, it is top notch, world class. I thought it was really, really great and believable. So it's great. It's a wonderful story about this this continent of factions and kingdoms that was kind of on the brink of peace, just being sucked into utter chaos and war by this one female warlord named Apollyon, and she's just totally insane and believes that the world is divided into wolves and sheep, predators and prey, and she's willing to do anything to bring out the wolves in all cultures and in all peoples, and then basically recruit them. So it's an interesting story. It's believable, plays on human nature, and was a lot of fun to play through. And then the multiplayer, as you know, I just am a huge fan of. I've gone through every tech test and alpha and closed beta, open beta. I've been playing this for a long time, and it's just fantastic. The second reservation I had going in was performance on the PS4.
Right.
I played the open beta on the PS4 after playing everything else on the PC. And on PC, everything runs at 60 frames per second. It's really smooth. It's great. It looks fantastic. The open beta on PS4 was a little less impressive. It was, I had to get used to 30 frames per second. There was some stuttering and some performance issues. Those were ironed out, I guess, for the retail version, because my experience has been much more pleasant, much smoother with the retail version. So yeah, it was everything I knew that I was going to get. It was everything I wanted. And then the fantastic single player campaign was just a huge bonus.
How's the online servers? Are they Rainbow Six Siege launch quality?
It's player to player servers. So, you know, if the person hosting the game decides to be a whiny baby because he's losing and he leaves, you have to sit there and wait for a host migration.
Okay.
A lot of people were whining about the P2P servers. It's not ideal, but they're not bad. And you know, even on NeoGAF, people are very critical. Whenever it's brought up, everybody's like, you know what? I haven't experienced any real lag. This is a very competitive game where timing is very important. Mm-hmm. Haven't experienced any issues with lag or latency or anything like that. That the most annoying thing that happens is when people rage quit and it happens to be a host, and then you have to sit there for about 3 seconds for the host to migrate. So
that's a bit of a buzzkill.
Yeah, it can be, but it really is a few seconds while that happens, and it's not that bad. But it is also not ideal, but it's not something that ruined my experience at all. So it didn't really factor in that heavily in my review.
You think it'd be worth, if somebody didn't like playing multiplayer, would it be worth them picking it up just for the single player? Or do you think the gameplay of it is so dual focused anyway that, I mean, you might as well be playing both?
The gameplay is, if you don't like the gameplay, you either are just not very good at it, or it's just not for you. I mean, it is more like a fighting game than anything else. It's more like a fighting game than like an action game second, and then almost kind of like adventure. But it's really one-on-one centric. I mean, even in Dominion mode, the multiplayer mode where there's lots of AI running around, the high point is when it's you and another player or a couple other players dueling. But they call the combat system the Art of Battle, and it is the most elegant and comprehensive third-person melee combat system I have ever experienced. And I think you and I, we were just playing Street Fighter V lately, and I was talking about how much I missed the flow of Soul Calibur, the flow of that combat and those combos and the back and forth and the parries. And I have found that again with For Honor. I think that's one reason I love it so much, is because there's such a wonderful flow and feeling of lucidity and control once you actually get your hands around and come to grips with this combat system. It's just very intuitive, you know, holding down the trigger to ready yourself. And then you basically are holding the sword with your right thumb and directing it. And, you know, once you get past that basic level of control where you understand the directional offense and defense, that's when you can really dig in and look at the moves list. And once you master the moves list, you can start focusing on switch ups and cancels, and then you'll stumble across things you didn't know you could do, or moves that link into other moves that you didn't know were there. It is so much like Soul Calibur in that way. I had that same evolution. You find a character or class you love, you learn everything they can do, and then you start learning how to use that huge repertoire of moves together in your own way. I mean, I play as the peacekeeper mainly in For Honor, and I play plenty of other peacekeepers, and I can duel three in a row, and it's like playing three different characters. It just depends on how you use them. You can pour your own personality and your own style of offense and defense into these characters because they're so diverse in what they can do, and it controls so well. That communicates perfectly into the single player story campaign, to get back to your question. And I think that it is cinematic enough and long enough to justify the buy-in price if somebody just wants to play this and sing. And by the way, any of the multiplayer modes, you can play purely with AI, and you can adjust AI levels as well.
Cool.
So there's a lot there. If you never want to take this online and play against other people, you have a fantastic and lengthy single-player campaign. And then any of the multiplayer modes, you can play with AI bots as well.
You know what I like about it compared to, say, a traditional fighting game, is that the moves are all there right in front of you. It's not about doing a difficult input. It's not about memorizing combos. It's not about memorizing frame data and all this shit. It's just, you're kind of playing rock, paper, scissors, but you can see what they're going to do a split second before they do it. Yeah. And it's very simple. They just give you an arrow. So there's no hidden information. And anyone can, you can, at a very simple level, you just know, well, I'll just block the way the arrow tells you and hit the way their arrow isn't. It's like scoring a goal in Blades of Steel. And then you can go beyond that. And I think that that's, people talk about in game design all the time, simple to pick up and difficult to master. And it seems like this game has mastered that, that technique.
You're exactly right.
And because you and me, we picked up Street Fighter, well, I picked up Street Fighter 5 because you had it, because we were looking for something simple to play, and it was, it's almost like the magic wasn't there, and I keep talking about the game on the Switch I want to play is Ultra Street Fighter, just a bare-bone Street Fighter again, and I don't have to worry about any of this excessive stuff where it's like, do I want to go down the rabbit hole of learning all of Cammy's frame data? Not really, because then you're just, that's like an incredible mountain you're never going to summit. But something like this, where even if I didn't know the advanced moves, I don't think I would feel cheated if I was playing you, because the arrow's right there.
Yeah.
Everything's just right on the screen with all the info. So it's, I had a lot of fun playing the beta again. The thing with 60 frames per second to 30 frames, it's not that it's not that the jump from 60 to 30 is a horrific jump.
No.
Even though for some people that are used to it, it can be. It's more that when you're at 30, you have no room to dip. So when a game needs to buffer down and maybe it hits 28, or that's when you start feeling it. It's anytime it's below 30. But then again, for a game like this, I mean, you want it to be as fluid as possible. And it seems like 60 is incredibly important. If they can hard lock that at 30 and people get used to that timing, then they should be okay, but I could see that being pretty tough adjustment.
And it has been, even online, it's been very, it's not necessarily that it needs to be as smooth as possible, it just needs to be as consistent as possible, because it's so competitive, and it has been very consistent.
Very, very nice. I like the idea that you can play all the multiplayer modes with bots too. That's a nice way to just kind of people to dip their toes in.
Yep. And it's great for, like, you know, if you're really having, if you go online and you just keep getting your ass kicked by a certain class, load up a custom game, a one-on-one duel, and throw a bot in there of that class, and just click him down to level 2 or 1 and get used to his defending against his basic moves, because even basic attacks, like, each class has a different swing time. Like, some people reach way back and wind up, and you may block way too soon, leave yourself open for a hit. Whereas, you know, somebody like the Peacekeeper, their basic attacks are very fast, and you have to react very fast. So the ability to play any mode with bots is also, it's like the best practice mode, because you can always adjust their difficulty and ramp that up, and it just really helps a lot when you're learning.
This definitely seems like the best realization of a fight scene from a movie, from either a martial arts fight scene or sort of a Braveheart style fight scene. Of, you know, take it, like the Batman Arkham was a nice system, but it was way too simplistic. It basically kind of broke down to just spamming the attack button and then pressing block whenever it told you. But this game, you need to think a little bit more for yourself, and it just takes it so much further. It's really nice to see Ubisoft come up with another really innovative property. They've been stagnant for a long time with Assassin's Creed and Watch Dogs and Far Cry and all these like tower games, but they've released another fantastic multiplayer game right up there with Rainbow Six Siege.
Yeah, and they'll be supporting it like Rainbow Six Siege. It's the same model. They're going to come out with every season. They're going to have new warriors and new maps. And the new maps are for everybody and everything, including the new warriors, you can earn in game without buying into the season pass if you want to. So everybody stays together, and they're in to support this long term, which is great, because it is such a good new IP. So fresh, so exciting, so good.
The only sticking point for me is that they should have service for this. If they, you know, like if you want to say you're going to be supporting it, I mean, put your money where your mouth is. Give people dedicated service.
It's super nice.
Yeah. But like you're saying, it hasn't really affected it. And you're a stickler for performance, especially in a game like this. I remember when we had both played Mankind Divided, I didn't realize that it was stuttering.
Yeah.
And then you mentioned it, and I went back, and it was
like, pacing issues are the worst, man. That's I think that's one reason I can't enjoy Bloodborne, as acclaimed as it is.
Sure. And, you know, that's a game. It's all about speed and timing as well. So, you know, stuttering around you, like waking up in the Matrix. All right. That was fun. I stayed up till about 6 a.m. last night trying to beat the last mission in Mankind Divided. I've been setting aside some time. I'm like, all right, I'm just going to put half an hour in here, half an hour in here. And I got to the point where I'm like, this feels like the end. And the final mission is a very, very difficult boss battle unless you know how to do it. And I end up looking up the solution. And you're fighting this like big mech guy and he has all these mechanic drones. And he was just a bullet sponge and he deals so much damage. So I was trying to like...
Is this going to be an in-game spoiler? I don't care because I'm never going to pick it back up. But just in case anybody's listening and they want to play this.
Yeah. I'll keep it very, very unspoilery. The ending boss is a big bullet sponge. And and it's very difficult. And I tried, you know, ducking out of vents because Adam Jensen loves being in vents.
Yep.
And taking shots at him. But it was just like, it was just never ending. And he had so much backup with him. And then if I looked up online and incredibly simple way that was almost stupid. So stupidly simple. It went from, I mean, I went up to this guy with like this Devastator shotgun and unloaded probably 30 rounds, like point blank range. It was like playing The Division.
Yeah.
And then, that's another Ubisoft game. And then it was like headshot after headshot and explosions and stuff. But what took him down was this other technique I'll let people discover on their own. Then the ending story hits. And they wrap it up real quick. They kind of have this extra little montage video where this newscaster is basically going over some side missions you've done and maybe the result you had in them because there's branching paths with that. But they leave a lot open. Super open-ended. It is so obvious that they want to have a sequel. And then they put the franchise on hiatus.
Yep.
Like, screw you guys.
Yep.
But if it wasn't for this open-ended ending, which I'm hardly disappointed in because the story itself was terrible, I'm glad. I think Eidos Montreal has... I think they need to give this to somebody else. Somebody else needs to work on this game. Because Human Revolution was a nice reboot. But I would say that because Mankind Divided doesn't do that much better than Human Revolution, here's what it does really well. The cities are finally big again. The first Deus Ex, the best thing about it was that first map, Statue of Liberty, is massive. Huge. Would take you minutes and minutes to walk across. And that gives you so many different avenues. And that's what people liked about it. Deus Ex Invisible War number 2, everybody hated it because they had to have it on Xbox as well. And the Xbox only had like 64 megabytes of RAM. So the levels were all these tiny little airport lobbies. They'd be like, you're in Seattle. Like, no, I'm not. I'm in a room connected to two other rooms. And there's two people here. Every city was like that. Oh, wow. Now you're in exotic Japan. Yeah. And everything was so muddy. Human Revolution opened it up a little bit, but still felt very hubby. But what Mankind Divided does well is they have this Prague open hub. And it's very big. There's very distinct districts. There's a red light district. There's a sewer system underneath. There's a huge bank level that in itself is probably the highlight of the game in terms of a sandboxy place to infiltrate. Does that well. The combat feels a little bit better. They don't nail the level design. I think they really miss having the guy who did Invisible War, actually, who ended up going on to do Dishonored 1 and 2. Dishonored 1 and 2 are the best Deus Ex games since Deus Ex.
That's interesting.
If you're looking for really good stealth combat, branching stories, and actual multiple ways of doing something, play Dishonored. They're fucking amazing.
Let me ask you, just to interrupt, and you can get right back to Mankind Divided. Yeah. I want to play Dishonored 2. I need to play Dishonored 1?
You can just play 2. Dishonored is not about the story at all. The story's very, very secondary to it. Dishonored 2 has these like little tiny comics in between each thing, and then you do most of the storytelling through the environment. All you need to know from the first one is that your dad did some stuff, and now you can either continue on his story or her story. It doesn't really matter. The story in Dishonored 2 is actually kind of weak. This evil lady comes out of nowhere, this evil aunt that you didn't know existed, and just tells everyone in the land, she's like, I'm in charge now, and everyone goes, all right. Okay, yeah. And then they kick you out. It's all about your way of getting back. So the thing with Mankind Divided is they try to go for this, like, hey, multiple ways of doing something. But it's, instead of it being like the first game where it was, I could go, you know, 50 miles that way, 2 game miles this way, or I could go down to the docks, or I could go like underneath the sewers, or I could go up on that building. Mankind Divided is like in the same room. There's a wall that can be broken if you have that upgrade. There's a vent right up there. And then there's like a door you could hack. And it's all in the same fucking screen.
Yeah.
And you don't get sectioned off when you upgrade your characters. So very quickly, you'll have every ability. So it's, yeah, like, okay, I see that you're giving me the option, but it's not really in the same spirit of it. It's just technically the options are there, but you don't feel like you're discovering anything. You're just kind of picking. It's like a game show where they're like, door number 1, 2, or 3. So the level design isn't really all there. The combat is not great. It is better than, it's probably the best Deus Ex has ever seen, for sure. But, it, you know, you played it. It's not a shooter.
Yeah.
The worst part about the story, I mean, about the game, is the story. What they do is they want to be mysterious. So instead of giving you answers, they give you more questions. Every time you think you find something out, what they do is, instead of learning what's the deal with this first guy, they're like, yeah, now we learned about a new organization. And by the time you're like 3/4 of the way through the story, there's 5 organizations you have to keep track of. There's like ARK. They're being framed by these guys, and those guys are a part of it. Now we have to go see if these guys too. And there's nothing ever gets resolved until the very end. Out of nowhere, you hit this ending, and you don't care. Why should you? It's there wasn't enough payoff. They just thought they're being so clever and keeping you on this like breadcrumb trail. The best moments of the story are a few of the side missions where they hit some good moments. They make you make some tough decisions. I'll tell you, one was so surprising. I'm so used to games sort of holding your hand through it. You know, I go through the motions, you do this. And I wasn't actually paying enough attention as I should have when I was helping this detective solve a case. And then all of a sudden you have the option, like, should you implicate this person or implicate that one? And I actually had to stop and look at my notes again and go, oh, okay. And then really think about it, make a moral choice. So every once in a while, they come up with, I'd say there's like 3 or 4 brilliant Deus Ex-y moments, but overall, and the general overall story arc is probably the worst in the whole series.
So that's a shame.
But it's, if you're looking for a Deus Ex type experience, there is enough there to keep you going.
Yeah. Well, it kept you going.
Yeah. I always had this itch to get back to it, and I liked just messing around in the world, going, doing the bank level. You don't even need a mission. I mean, just that part they nail pretty well. And some of the infiltrations can get very, very challenging with all the different lasers and stuff. If you are playing the game, I'll give you a hint. Get the remote hacking. That way, anything you see, you can just not have to get up close to it, and you do this like quick little mini game, and you can shut things off and all that shit. So yeah, I played it. And then this DLC I'm checking out, Rift, has this...
All right.
Yeah, has this opening cutscene between Adam and a guy from a previous game. And it is 10 times better than every other conversation in Mankind Divided. The way that they talk, the way that they interrupt each other. Adam actually has emotions. Like, he's still stoic, but he has these very subtle... to his face. It was like watching an Uncharted game. I'm like, oh God, I'm like getting so many more layers of it. And I wish the whole game was like that. And I think the biggest problem with Mankind Divided was that the development was divided. And it's very, I know that big AAA games take hundreds of people to make, and several studios will work on them. They just might not be, they might not have their name on the box. But I've never seen a game where it was so obvious. Where Adam stands next to another character, and Adam's like, yeah, I'm glistening and wet and all the money went into me. And then this other character's like, I was made by another studio and I look like I'm from a fucking completely different game. A lot of times they look like Telltale characters. Like, they're really kind of mannequin-y.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about. Whereas I encountered a few of those.
Yeah, like Adam looks quite realistic and he's, you know, he's modeled nicely.
Yeah.
And then these other people come in and they're like, what are you talking about, Adam? Kill the Oggs. So, if you're a big Deus Ex fan, yeah, it's worth it. You've probably already played it, but if you were curious about it, I wouldn't. I'd go back and play the first one. Yeah, $30 used in Canada. So probably 20 in America. All right. Yeah. That's probably about it for what I've been playing in games. I've been trying to get through Persona 4 Golden.
Yeah, you have.
I'm stuck on this reset.
Gotta grind, dude. Gotta grind.
Yeah, I picked it up and I was like, listen to the dialogue in the dungeon. I thought, why did I put this down? And then I faced the boss in Shadow Teddy. Yeah. After you get Rise. That's a fun dungeon. The bathhouse?
Rise.
Sorry. Gomen Nasai. And sorry in chat.
Gomen
Nasai. All right. Schooling me. Taking me to Gakko. That's school.
That's the only Japanese I know.
You must watch anime. You know those people that watch anime and they think they know Japanese?
Oh, man.
Basically. Yeah, this I am like totally unleveled to fight this Shadow Teddy. So then I tried to go down to like, but how? I go down to level, I back away from the boss door and go down to level 10 and I'm getting destroyed. Then I go to floor 9, getting destroyed. These tanks keep coming up and shooting me with these ice blocks.
Maybe you need to change your party up a little bit. Maybe you have personas that have weaknesses that are being exploited by the enemies.
Oh, think about it. I need to use my brain and strategy. Who's your persona party?
Oh my gosh, it's been a while. If you know, it does depend on the dungeon and it depends on the main, because like, you know, whereas the main protagonist can switch out his persona at any given time, and those all have different elemental resistances and weaknesses. Your other main casts, I'm not sure, like, if you haven't recruited Rise, I'm not sure who else you have available to you, obviously.
I got Yukiko.
Mm-hmm.
Chie.
And Yosuke, obviously.
Yosuke, yeah. And then I've got Kenji.
Kenji, yeah. So it. You would only leave out one person, right?
Yeah, Kenji's just wait. He's watching it.
Yeah. So I don't know, maybe like if you notice if ice is doing, is exploiting a weakness of one of your characters, maybe swap them out. And I don't remember what Kenji is resistant and weak to, but that's usually like with every dungeon, there'll be at least one or two characters that are going to be resistant to a lot of the enemies that you're encountering, and definitely the boss. Once you face a boss for the first time, you'll notice like a lot of his attacks that hit all the enemies at once. Like if three out of your four party members are weak to an element that the boss can do, you know, with a single spell, attack all of you with one element, that's obviously not the way you want to go. So you just have to kind of swap out and find for any given situation what works best.
That sounds so unbelievably simple now that you say it. And I feel stupid for just trying the same thing over and over again. My problem is my main guy just keeps dying. Once he's dead, game over.
All of the Shin Megami Tensei games are very, they make you use your full arsenal of spells, like use buffs, use anything to get your defense up, use things to get the enemy defense down. Like buff spells in most RPGs are always like totally secondary and useless, like when you could just use great attack magic and stuff.
Yeah.
But in Shin Megami Tensei games and even Persona, which is a little easier than most of the mainline Shin Megami Tensei series, you need to use your buff and debuff magic. It is very central and important in the tougher fights.
That is the fun part about that game. And the fun part about turn-based combat in general is that strategy. Having the time to think about it. Being down. I love in a turn-based combat game where where you've got 50 health. You're like, did I try to finish them off? Did I do a heal? And that, it's like those decisions are...
It's like looking over the chessboard.
And it's... I just really want to get back to the story, too. The story's fucking great. And this... I don't know what's... I cannot wait to find out what is the thread between these people that are getting, attacked. And who is doing it? And what's happening?
You have many twists to come.
Oh, my God. So good. On that TV. They do. And because the fog comes and then they give you all this time, just like a limited amount of time to get things done. It's a really great game mechanic.
It really is.
Hey, when's Persona 5 coming out? You must know the exact day.
April 4th.
April 4th, Persona Attendance Day. Yes. Oh, man, you must be excited. How much of the Japanese version did you play?
You know, that's hard to say. I would say, I don't know, 8 hours?
Okay.
It was tough, like, obviously.
Yeah.
I didn't really... I could tell what was very obviously happening because I could see it, but not understanding a lot of the context was kind of a buzzkill. I still, even though I've put in that amount of time, I feel like nothing has been super spoiled for me. Because the only main dungeon I saw was the first one, and they've shown that in a couple streams. So I feel like most of the game would be totally fresh to me.
Yeah. And I mean, I think the story's the best part.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
It's all going to be fresh for you. I heard a story of this guy playing through Final Fantasy VII, the Japanese version. I guess he didn't have the English one at the time, and he just made up his own story. Really liked it. Then when he played the English version, he was disappointed. He had gotten
not
so,
that impressed, huh?
Yeah, I got so attached to his. I think Final Fantasy VII's got a pretty good story. I think it's easy to hate on that game, and it has a deceptively story about identity and heroes.
Yeah.
And sort of video game tropes in general. Definitely a game that held up when I went back to it. All right, my friend. I guess that is it. Thank you for joining us, for telling us about For Honor. We'll see you next week. Thanks, everybody, for watching. If you like this and you know somebody that might like it too, please share it. We really appreciate it. Let us know if we can do something for you. You can tweet me at GameThinkTalk. And Matt?
I am at MatthewFace, and that is Matthew with two T's.
Got it. Bye, everybody.
Right on.